The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. The title of the story we're about to tell you is The Unseen and the Seen. We have borrowed the words from a famous American writer, Henry James, novelist and essayist, who wrestled all his long life with the perplexities of man's existence. This is what he wrote in 1888. The power to guess the unseen from the seen may be said to constitute experience.
Who did it?
I certainly didn't.
And could one of the servants have done it?
The only one who sleeps in the house is Selma.
Well?
But I can't believe Selma would do such a thing.
If she didn't, then it must have been one of the children.
Our mystery drama, The Unseen and the Seen, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Elspeth Eric and stars Paul Hecht and Carol Tytel. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Is there anyone who has not wondered what lies beyond the evidence of the senses? Who has not looked deep into the heart of a rose, listened to the sound of a bird's song, heard the laugh of a very young child, felt the stirrings of love, without wanting to know the secrets all of them hold? Is anyone really satisfied with what he sees, hears, smells, tastes, or feels? Or does the great mystery torment us all? Listen now to the drama of one man's experience, a singular drama called The Unseen and the Seen.
Selma, I'm taking Mr. Campion's breakfast into the living room. It'll make everything simpler. Donald? Donald?
Yes, Mona?
Are you dressed?
Just about.
Well, you are going to the bank, aren't you?
Don't I always?
I was just asking.
Why all the anxiety?
I'm not anxious. I just... Oh, my goodness. Oh, goodness gracious. Oh, dear. What in the world? How did that happen? Donald! Donald, are you coming down?
Right away, Mona. What's the big hurry?
Well, a very peculiar thing. I just discovered it. I want to show you.
Coming! I'm coming right now.
I'm in the living room. I brought your breakfast in here.
Well, good morning, dear mother-in-law.
Your breakfast is over there on the side table by the window. Selma is polishing the dining room furniture. She wanted to get at it early, so I brought your breakfast in here.
Okay.
Before you sit down, Donald, I want you to look at something.
Oh, what's that?
I haven't touched it. I want you to see it just the way I found it.
Well, what is it?
It's your wedding picture. You and Bernice. The day you were married.
Well, what's it doing on the floor?
That's what I'd like to know.
Oh, must have fallen off the mantelpiece.
Donald, that picture has stood in the same spot on the mantelpiece for 15 years. It's never fallen down before.
Well, this time it did.
Look at it. Face up, lying on the floor. The glass isn't even broken. It's just lying there.
Well, it is possible that it fell off the mantelpiece without breaking the glass.
That old mantelpiece is 5 feet off the floor.
Well, even so, it could happen. It's one of those lucky things. Somebody knocked it down.
If somebody knocked it down, why didn't that same somebody put it back?
Well, forgot, I guess. Do you mind if I eat my breakfast?
You never wanted that picture left on the mantelpiece, did you?
No, actually, I did not. After Bernice died, it was a painful reminder of the past. I wanted to put it away somewhere, but... Well, when you moved in and brought Selma with you, I was grateful having somebody to run the house and look after the children. Oh, maybe I have never thanked you properly, but... I really was grateful. I am grateful. I don't know how I'd have managed without you, without Selma.
Well, somebody had to do it.
Well, it was very kind of you. Especially when one considers that you never much wanted me for a son-in-law.
Donald, that's not true. may have been true at the very beginning when you were fussing around with your painting, but not after.
Not after I stopped painting and went into father-in-law's bank.
And became a very good banker. He always said you were very competent.
Competent. Yes, competent. Well, don't you want some breakfast?
You might pour me some coffee. I suppose I might as well put the picture back where it belongs.
Might as well. Well, here's your coffee.
No, it bothers me. How it could have got on the floor like that.
Forget it.
Well, somebody must have put it there.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Deliberately.
What does it matter?
It matters to me. I should think it would matter to you.
Well, it doesn't. Not a bit. Now, it fell down or got knocked down or got taken down. So what? Now, stop trying to make a big thing out.
Well, I was only trying to...
I said forget it. I'm going to the bank.
Donald?
Yes?
Come in here, please, right away. I'm in the living room.
No, what's your problem?
It's not my problem, Donald. Donald, look there. On the side table.
Oh, it's the picture.
Your wedding picture.
Yes. What's it doing there, eh?
Donald, it happened again.
What, somebody moved it? Selma?
I asked her. She says she never went near it.
One of the children?
I asked Matthew and I asked Arthur. They didn't even know what I was talking about.
Stephanie?
Donald, Stephanie is 5 years old. She couldn't even reach it.
Oh, if she stood on a chair.
Why would she want to move it? A five-year-old child. I'm not sure she even remembers Bernice.
Well, that leaves you. And me.
I was waiting for you to say that.
You think I sneaked down here in the dead of night, took the picture off the mantel and placed it neatly on the side table. Now, why would I do that?
You could have walked in your sleep.
In all my 37 years, no one has ever accused me of walking in my sleep. How about you?
You know what I'm going to do?
No, what are you going to do?
I'm going to get some flour from Selma.
What?
And I am going to spread a coating of flour all over the mantelpiece.
You figure that...
I figure that whoever is doing this weird thing, Selma or Arthur or Matthew or Stephanie even...
Or you,
yes,
even.
Yes, or even you, whoever it is. The flower will be disturbed in some way.
Yes, well, that sounds reasonable.
Maybe even leave some fingerprints.
That's better, I guess, than sitting up all night and waiting to see who comes into this room.
Is that what you were going to do?
I had thought of it.
So did I.
Why didn't you suggest it?
I was afraid.
To suggest it or to do it?
Both.
Mm. Well, so was I.
Were you afraid to know who it is? Doing this crazy thing?
Maybe.
I know I was. I mean, I was afraid of confronting him with what he was doing.
Or what she was doing.
You thought it would be me.
Didn't you think it might be me?
Well, yes. Or worse.
What could be worse?
A ghost.
Bernice.
Yes.
That's ridiculous.
Yes, I know, but...
Why don't you go and ask Selma for some flour? Yeah, well, we'll do what you said. We'll spread it all over the mantelpiece.
All right. Ghosts don't leave any fingerprints, do they? I'm afraid to go in.
Yes, and you want to find out, don't you?
Well... Yes, I guess I do.
You were the one who was so neurotic about the whole thing.
Oh, you were too.
Not at first.
Well, you were last night.
Yeah, because you were.
Don't try to blame it all on me.
I wasn't even especially interested till you...
Till I said it might be a ghost. My daughter's ghost. Then you got very upset.
Yes, because it's an absurd idea. Oh, well, come on. Let's go on in.
You go first.
All right.
Is it there... Is it on the mantelpiece?
No. No, it's not.
Oh, Donald.
Come on in and look for yourself.
All right. Oh. It's really not there. Where is it?
Never mind where it is. Look at the mantelpiece where we spread the flower.
Oh, Donald. Donald, it's just the same.
Yes, it hasn't been disturbed a bit.
Does that mean...
I've no idea what it means.
Well, what are you doing?
I'm going to call Professor Dixon.
Well, who's he?
He's my professor at the academy. He taught me all I know about painting. We were very close. Still are, as a matter of fact.
Why are you calling him?
Because it's the only thing I can think of to do.
Yes? Hello?
Henry?
Yes?
This is Donald, Henry.
Donald? How are you, Donald?
Well, at the moment, I'm...
It's good to hear from you. Have you been doing any painting?
No, not lately, Henry.
Oh, too bad.
Yes, well, they keep me pretty busy at the bank.
Yes, I suppose they do. Well, what can I do for you, Donald? Or is this just a friendly social call?
No, it's not, as a matter of fact. It's something else.
Trouble? You in trouble?
Not exactly. Well, I'm really not sure.
Well, what is it, Donald?
Henry, could you come here for dinner tonight?
Oh, well, then this is a social call.
Partly. Not altogether. Can you make it?
Yes, I can.
Good. Well, that's fine.
Donald, is it my imagination, or do you sound a bit desperate?
No, it's not your imagination.
Well, then, I'll certainly come for dinner. 7 o'clock?
Henry, could you possibly stay overnight?
I don't know.
Please, Henry.
All right, Donald. I'll arrange to stay overnight.
Thank you, Henry. More than I can say. Thank you.
Oh, it's all right, really. See you at 7.
Thank you.
What was that all about? Why do you want this professor in the house, this Henry person?
I'll tell you why. Because he knows all about ghosts.
Let me read to you from the work of James M. Barrie, born well over a century ago. A house is never still in the darkness to those who listen intently. There is a whispering in distant chambers. An unearthly hand presses the bolt of the window. The latch rises. Ghosts were created when the first man woke in the night. I'll be back shortly to continue with Act Two. Listen to this, written by the 19th century dramatist Henrik Ibsen. It is not only what we have inherited that exists in us, but all sorts of old dead ideas and old dead beliefs. They are not actually alive in us, but they are dormant, and we can never be rid of them. Whenever I read a newspaper, I fancy I see ghosts creeping between the lines. There must be ghosts all over the world. Those lines are from Ibsen's play written in 1881 and titled Ghosts.
Of course, Professor Dixon, I don't know anything about painting, but I know what I like.
Well, that's something, isn't it, Donald?
Yes, I guess so. Have we finished dinner?
Well, there's coffee. I don't know if Selma fixed dessert. Such short notice, Professor, I'm not sure.
I've had a sufficiency. I really have.
Good, well then let's go into the living room.
Yes, do that, you two. I'll bring coffee in there.
Come on, Henry.
Selma, we'll have coffee in the living room.
Yes, I'm afraid dinner was a sad affair, Henry.
On the phone, you sounded so agitated. You made everything seem so urgent. I wondered why you kept postponing telling me.
Well, I wanted to be alone with you.
Oh.
Seemed to be somewhat at odds with my mother-in-law about, well, what you might call some strange goings-on in this house. We've even got to the point where we suspect each other, or if not each other, a ghost.
Come now. You're not serious.
Let me tell you what's been happening. Or seems to have been happening. No, no. It has been happening. I've seen the evidence, but I can't explain it. For the life of me, I just can't explain it.
Donald, just tell me.
All right, all right. Now you see that framed picture on the mantelpiece? Huh?
Yes, a photograph of you and Bernice on your wedding day.
Yes, well, it stood there in that exact spot ever since she and I were married. For 16 years. The twins were born a year later, Matthew and Arthur. She and I were still happy together. At least I think we were. I didn't much like working in a bank, but, well, we tried to make a go of it, make it work, as they say. Then Stephanie came 10 years later. I guess we thought another child would really hold us together, save the marriage. Yeah, we never had a chance to find out because, of course, Bernice died.
Yes, I know all that, Donald. What's it got to do with...
Yeah, I'm coming to that, Henry. Just give me time. Now, after Bernice died, her mother moved into the house to look after the children, and she brought Selma with her to do the housework. Now, this was almost 5 years ago, Henry.
Yeah.
Everything went along all right. Until now.
What's wrong now? Everything seems to be running smoothly.
Wait until you hear.
I'm waiting.
A few days ago, Mona came into this room and the wedding picture was lying on the floor. On the floor.
Fell off the mantelpiece.
Well, that's what I said at first. And then a while later, she found it on the side table there by the window.
Somebody moved it.
Well, nobody ever moved it before in all of these years. Mona had this outlandish idea of spreading flour around the picture to catch the criminal, as it were.
Huh.
Well, when we came down in the morning, the picture had been moved, all right, clear across the room. But the flour had not been disturbed. Not one bit.
Huh.
Yeah, well, that led to all sorts of arguments and accusations. Mona suspecting me suspecting her. Finally, she said it must be a ghost who was doing this incomprehensible thing.
A ghost? Really?
Well, that's when I called you. You know about such things.
My dear man, what did you think I could do? Exorcise a ghost for you?
No, but, I mean, you're interested in all this stuff. Parapsychology, the occult.
Well, everyone is interested in all that stuff. Whether they admit it or not, they're interested in it. They're fascinated by it.
I never was. Until now.
Well, you're right. I have been and still am. I suppose I've read everything that's been written on the subject. Gone to lectures, attended seances. It's become a sort of second career for me. Since I never became a creative artist, only a teacher. Much to my sorrow.
Yes. Well, Henry, let's get on with it. Well, what's the explanation? And what are we to do about it?
Well, to begin with, there's the explanation of the poltergeist. Sometimes called the noisy ghost.
Yeah, well, there wasn't any noise. Nobody heard a thing.
The theory of the poltergeist belongs in the realm of folklore and spiritism. It's merely a word to explain the inexplicable.
And that's all you're going to give me? A word? What good's a word?
Words have power.
Words no good.
Not so fast. Not so fast, my friend.
I've got to have more than a word.
Well, I'm about to give you more. In the last 50 years or more, a new and different theory has emerged. That we mortals possess a sort of energy that is capable of performing the kind of mischief that you've just described. Without being on the spot... Without even knowing he was doing it, or even wish to do it.
That's absurd.
Is it? You've heard of people who can bend spoons, haven't you, by the sheer force of their concentration?
Yes, I never believed it. And even if it's true, what's the good of bending spoons?
What's the good of moving a picture from one place to another?
Oh, I don't know. All I know is that it moved, or was moved.
Now, let's see. Who lives in the house at the present?
Besides myself? Well, there's Mona, Selma, the housekeeper, The twin boys, Matthew and Arthur.
How old are they now?
They're 14. And then there's Stephanie. She's 5.
14? That's a susceptible age.
What do you mean? There's nothing wrong with my sons.
Did I say there was anything wrong?
You said that...
I said susceptible. By that, I mean susceptible to all sorts of influences, from without and most particularly from within.
Yes, but I...
Oh, now, don't look so alarmed, my friend. Boys of 14 are at the height of their powers, physical, mental, and spiritual, and they have not yet learned to control them. Later they will.
Well, now, here's the coffee.
Ah, splendid.
Here, I'll just set it down here. Well, now... Have you two been discussing our little problem of cream or sugar, Professor Dixon?
Black, thank you.
Mona...
Yeah, I know you take yours black, Donald.
Mona, there's something I want you to do.
And what's that?
I want you to enroll Matthew and Arthur in that military school.
What did you say?
And take them up there. Get them out of this house. Mona! Mona! Come in here!
What is it, Donald?
Get in here, right away!
Well, where are you?
What do you think? I'm in the living room now. Hurry up!
I'm coming! Donald, you look awful.
Look there on the windowsill.
Oh, no. The photograph.
Yes, it's happened again. 2 whole weeks of peace and quiet, and now, look, it's happened again. That the picture has moved from the mantel clear across the room to the windowsill.
What are we to do?
That vase, that Chinese vase, was it always there by the bookcase? Wasn't it next to the door, to the right of the door?
I don't remember. I don't know.
Why don't you know? You're the one who takes care of things in this house.
Please. Try to calm down, please, my dear.
I thought when we sent the boys away to the school...
Do you want me to fetch them back? If you do,
No. Let them stay where they are.
Well, then, what do you want?
What do I want? I want...
I'll do anything. Just tell me.
I'll tell you what I want.
Anything at all.
Yes, I want you to take Stephanie. Take Stephanie and... Go someplace.
Someplace? Where?
Well, you could go abroad.
With a 5-year-old child.
Take her to Florida. That's it. Take her to Disneyland. She'd like that, wouldn't she? Yes, of course she would. She'd love that. Yes, Florida. Yes, Mona. Take her there. Show her all those marvelous things. She'll be crazy about that. And you'll like it too, won't you? Yes, of course you will. Good. So, all settled, right? Yes. You'll take Stephanie to Florida. Yes. Out of this house. And I can have some peace of mind. Yes. I'll have some peace of mind. At last. Yes, come in.
You wish to see me?
Yes, Selma. Close the door, please.
Yes, sir.
Now, sit down, Selma. Yes, that's it. Selma, I have a favor to ask of you.
Yeah?
I don't quite know how to put this to you. It's very difficult. I don't want to frighten you or anything.
Something I should be frightened about?
No, not really. Anyway, I don't think so. That photograph on the mantelpiece, have you ever moved it?
Only to dust.
You always put it right back?
Oh, yeah.
In the same place?
Oh, yeah.
So, as far as you know, you never put it on the windowsill or the side table or any place but right there.
No, never.
Then why did I find it on the coffee table this morning? Huh? Why was it there when I came down this morning?
On the coffee table? I don't know. I never.
I never would have.
All right, Selma. I'm sorry. All right. There's nothing to cry about. Now look. Here's a check.
Oh my.
It's for $1,000. Now I want you to take it and go on a vacation. There must be someone you can visit. Friends, relatives.
Yeah.
Stay away as long as you like. And if you need more money, you just write me and ask for it. Now,
yeah.
Leave this house. You understand?
Yeah.
I like it very much if you could go tonight.
You sit and thank you, sir.
Yes.
Are you all right, sir?
Yes, I'm quite all right. I'm quite all right. All right. Oh, yes. I am fine. I am fabulous. Fantastic. I'm just simply wonderful. Never been better. Absolutely super.
Hello?
Henry, is that you?
Donald?
Henry, the boys are at military school. Mona's taken Stephanie to Florida. There's been nobody in this house for a whole week, except for Selma and myself. Henry, last night, it happened again. The picture, it moved to the coffee table. I've just given Selma some money and told her to take a vacation. So now, I'm all alone in this big house. I'm frightened, Henry. I'm scared to death.
Ghosts are very powerful, and never more so than when one is alone. It matters very little if one believes in their existence. It doesn't even matter whether or not they exist. To a haunted mind, they are as real as his own face, his own hands, his own voice, and twice as powerful. I'll be back with our concluding act shortly. Close your eyes, lie back, and think of all the ghosts you know, or have acquaintance with, or knowledge of. Does Shakespeare hover in the shadows? Is that Einstein just outside the window? Or is it your own great-grandfather peering in at you? Oh, don't turn away. Listen to them. They have things to tell you.
If you could stay on here for a while, Henry. Just a little while, till I get my nerves together, you know?
I know.
I'm pretty shaken up by this whole thing.
Yeah, I can see you are.
And I'm so alone here.
I'll stay.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Henry. Take any room you like. There are plenty of them. You know, I'm very grateful to you, Henry.
Oh, there's no need to be.
Oh, the house seems so big. So empty.
I can imagine.
Of course, it is empty, isn't it, Henry? Well, it's always been a big house. Too big, really. I've often thought that, I mean, before all this happened, this peculiar business has just made things worse, made the house bigger somehow. Sometimes I wish I hadn't sent them all away, but I had to, didn't I?
Well, if you...
Even Selma. Wasn't quite so bad when Selma was here. Not that Selma and I knew each other well at all. We didn't. Mona knew her, but I didn't. Still, it was somebody in the house. Another person. You know what I mean.
Yes.
But I had to send her away. Because, after all, she could have been the one.
Donald, remember what I told you?
Oh, yes, about poltergeists. Oh, yes, I remember. Noisy ghosts, you called them, eh? Able to move things around.
No, not that.
That's what you said.
Well, that's not all I said.
I remember distinctly.
I said that the power to move inanimate objects could also come from the unconscious mind. from a submerged wish, fiercely aggressive, full of indignation and resentment.
But who could... Who?
What's the matter? Have I said something?
Who would hate me so much?
Hate you?
To punish me this way, Henry? Could it be Bernice, do you think? From beyond the grave?
Why don't you go to bed, Donald? You're worn out.
Yes. Yes, I think I am. Well, let's go upstairs.
All right.
You want to take Mona's room? It's rather...
Oh, in any room at all.
No. I'd better give you the boy's room. Take either bed.
Okay.
Wait a second, Henry. I just want...
What is it, Donald?
I just want to take a peek in the living room. I do it every night. There. Do you see?
Do you see it? On the mantelpiece.
It is there, isn't it?
You mean the photograph?
Of course I mean the photograph. You do see it, don't you, Henry? Well, do you see it?
Yes, Donald, I see it.
All right, then. Now let's go upstairs.
What's the matter?
Get down here, for the love of heaven. Don't leave me here alone.
I'm coming. I'll be right there.
Where is it? Where is the blasted thing? Where is it this time?
What's the matter, Donald?
It's got to be somewhere. Ah, there. There you are. Ha! Stuffed down between the back of the chair and the cushion. Thought I wouldn't see you. I knew you had to be someplace. And here you are.
It's the photograph, isn't it?
Yes, of course it's the photograph. No matter what I do, it's no use. It's no use.
Donald.
But you saw it, didn't you, last night? It was on the mantelpiece, wasn't it? You saw it there, didn't you? I showed it to you.
Yes.
All right. This morning, it's in the chair. Between the cushion and the back. Now, how did it get there, huh? Nobody was in the house but you and me. Did you do it?
What?
Did you move that picture from the mantel to the chair? Was it you, huh? Are you the one who's trying to drive me crazy?
Donald, stop and think. Try to calm down.
Yes, it must have been you. Mona's in Florida. The boys are at school. Stephanie's with Mona. And Selma is off somewhere spending my money. I got rid of all of them. There was just the two of us in this house.
You think that I would come down here in the middle of the night?
You told me it wasn't necessary for anybody to physically move something. You said the force of the unconscious, something like that. Yes, that's how you did it. You know all about these crazy things. You studied them. You know how they're done.
Please, Donald.
You did it. You did it.
You know, Donald.
It had to be you.
No, Donald.
If it wasn't you, then who was it, huh? Who was it?
You, Donald. It was you.
Me? I did it?
Yes. You.
I wouldn't do a thing like that. Why would I? What reason would I have to do a thing like that? You think I want to drive myself crazy?
Something like that, perhaps.
Henry. Listen, Henry. Will you stay? Will you stay here for a while? A few weeks. Something like that.
If you want me to.
Oh, I do. I do, Henry. It's vital. Somebody has to check on the picture. See if it moves.
But you can do that.
No. No, you see, because I won't be here. You'll be here alone.
Where will you go?
I don't know. Somewhere. You see, I have to get myself out of this house to see if I'm the one.
When will you be back?
Don't know.
Sometime, I guess. Thanksgiving, yes. I'll be back for Thanksgiving, for dinner. Then you can tell me, you know, if the picture stayed on the mantelpiece or if it moved.
Donald, are you home? Donald, did Selma show up? She said she would.
Hello. Happy Thanksgiving Day.
Oh, hello, Professor. It's so good to see you. Are you going to be here for dinner?
I'm not sure.
Oh, you must. Unless you have other plans. Did Selma arrive?
She's in the kitchen now.
Well, she wrote me Donald gave her some time off.
Yes, I believe he did.
I left Stephanie at a friend's house. I'll just speak to Selma, and then I'll go get her. Are the boys here?
Yeah, they're in their room.
Could I impose on you, Professor? Ask you to take my bag up to my room. It's right at the top of the stairs.
Oh, yes. I know where it is. I've been using it for a month now.
Oh? You've been keeping Donald company?
That was the idea.
Oh, I'm glad.
In the beginning. But then...
Yes, Donald was in a real state. I was worried about him. How is he?
Well, I'm afraid he's still in a real state.
Is it that photograph? His wedding picture?
I'm afraid it is.
It's moved again.
After you left with Stephanie and Selma had gone, he asked me to come over. I did, of course. We had dinner. He was very lonely, very depressed.
He made us all go away. We didn't want to.
He had his mind set on finding out why and how the picture moved off the mantelpiece. After dinner, he asked me to check the living room with him. We both saw the picture in its usual place, and we both went upstairs. The next morning, I heard a terrible scream. I came running downstairs. The picture had moved in the night. Donald accused me of having moved it by some sort of psychic energy. I had a hard time convincing him. And finally, I told him outright. I told him... He was the one. I think he believed me.
But is it true? Are you right? Is Donald the one?
I'm afraid it's been Donald all along.
Sorry to make you help set the table, but Selma's been awfully busy in the kitchen.
I don't mind at all.
And Donald dismissed all the other servants right after... Oh, where is he? Where did he go?
I've no idea. But he did say he'd be back for Thanksgiving. Of course, he was in a very agitated state when he left. I'm not sure he even remembers what he said.
The children. What am I supposed to say to the children if he doesn't show up?
I really don't know.
Well, they'll be so upset. Matter of fact, so will I. Even if he's responsible for everything, I'm really very fond of him.
Yes, yes, so am I.
You taught him how to paint, didn't you?
Well, I taught him all I could.
You know, I never liked Donald's paintings. I tried to, but couldn't.
Are we all through setting the table?
Yes, I guess we are. We've set a place for Donald, haven't we? Did you hear that?
Yes. Wasn't it the front door?
Yes, I think it was. Do you suppose it...
I hope it is.
Hello, Mona.
Ah.
Henry.
Hello, Donald.
Well, hello, my dear.
How are the children here?
Well, they're upstairs. They're getting ready for dinner.
Selma?
You're basting the turkey.
Good, good.
Donald, where have you been? It's been more than a month.
If you don't feel like telling us...
No, I don't mind telling you. I've been painting.
Painting?
You've been... Painting?
Yeah, well, there didn't seem to be anything else to do.
Well, I think it was a very good thing to do.
Oh, I don't know. Hey, you want to see some of my stuff?
I most certainly do.
Well, there's a whole portfolio, if you want to look at it.
Of course I do.
Yeah, here we are. Only sketches. A few watercolors. Nothing very significant.
Yeah.
Rough sketches, really. That's all. I thought maybe later on I might develop some of them.
But... Donald, they're good.
They're very, very good.
You mean that?
Oh, I most certainly do mean that. They're very good. They're excellent, really.
Well, imagine that. Henry, what I really want to know is... Well, did anything happen once I was out of the house?
You mean, did the picture move?
Yes, that's what I mean.
Yes, it did. It moved the night you left. And then it didn't move anymore.
Do you care to tell me where it moved to?
Well, as a matter of fact, I found it the next morning in the trash can.
Really? I must have hated that picture a lot.
Donald, remember what I told you about a psychic force that can move inanimate objects? Well, when that psychic force turns to other things, constructive things, like painting, like any creative work, then it stops its futile gesturing, moving things about, and expends itself on the work it was meant to do. Understand?
Yes. Yes, you must be right, Henry. Because the day after I left this house, the very next morning, I went to work. I started painting again. Oh, Mona, why don't you call the children for dinner?
I told you ghosts are powerful, and it's true, they are. But other things are powerful, too. Things such as abandoned hopes, buried ambitions, neglected talents. Once set free, such things can exorcise the most ferocious ghost in the world and send him weeping back into the mists whence he came. I'll be back shortly. Do you want to paint a picture? Do you feel like composing a song? Have you the urge to write a poem, a story, a novel? Do you long to play the piano or the violin or the guitar? Then for heaven's sakes, do it. Do it. For your own sake. And because it keeps the ghosts away. Our cast included Paul Hecht, Carol Tytel, and Court Benson. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant